find the link and share it.
Declare.
The word says in Psalm 33, let the godly sing for joy to the Lord, for he is fitting and pure to praise him. I want to ask you, how many godly people do we have here today? Now, you might some, maybe it's the folks that are watching online that might say, well, I'm not a very godly person because we don't want to think of ourselves bigger than what we are or better than who we are. We look in the mirror every day and we know what we forget last night, did last night. We know what we did this morning. And we don't maybe feel very godly sometimes. But the word says that we're not godly because of what we have done or because of how we feel, right? I am an American not because of anything other than I took an oath and said, I'll be a citizen. You are an American probably because you were just born here. Not anything you did, you just are by virtue of what was done on your behalf. And let me tell you, you are godly not because of who you are or what you did, but because of who he is and what he did on your behalf. And it says it is good and it is right for the godly to sing praise and to sing with joy unto the Lord. It is fitting for the pure to pray. Well, I'm not very pure. If you've been washed in the blood of Jesus, you can't get any purer than you are. It says, sing a new song of praise to him. You see, we can sing an old song. We can sing the song that's been sung for generations. Or we can sing a new song, a song that was new this morning when I woke up and I realized I'm redeemed, I'm washed in the blood, and I'm saved. That's a new song. I don't want you singing yesterday's song today. I don't want you singing tomorrow's song today. I want you singing today's new song today. The song that's going to get you for this day today. It says, play skillfully. And thank God we have people who can play skillfully on pianos and drums and organs and whatever else. He says, why do we do all these things? Why? Verse 4. For the word of God holds true. And we can trust in everything he does. He loves that which is just and good, and his unfailing love fills the earth. That's why I can sing a new song today, because as sure as I'm standing here today, and I know the color of my eyes, Brother Bill, his word was true to me yesterday, his word will be true to me today, and his word will be true to me tomorrow. Therefore, I can sing a new song. His faithfulness is new today, therefore I can sing a new song. His mercy is new to me today, so I can sing a new song to him today. And I'm going to encourage you this morning, get in his presence. Love and honor him. Don't sing what you've always sung, and don't do what you've always done. Do something new today in praise to the King. Come on, lift your hand at this house today. Everybody in this room, indulge me for a few minutes here. Lift up your voice. Don't let mine be the only one praying. Right now, you lift up your voice and say, Father, I'm here to worship you. I'm here to love you. I'm here to honor you. I'm here to bless you. But Lord, today, help me to sing a new song. Help me not to sing yesterday's song. Help me not to sing tomorrow's song. Help me to sing a new song for a new season on a new day. Your mercy is new to me today, and therefore my praise will be new to you. Move in this house, we pray. Lord Jesus, right now, I pray the Holy Ghost will come in this place. He will disrupt the atmosphere. He will disrupt the plans of the enemy and the assignments of the enemy, and that the will of God will be unleashed in this house. We believe you today, Lord, for those who are under the sound of our voice, Lord, today, to be saved, to be healed, to be delivered, to be filled and baptized with the Holy Ghost. And we believe you for all these things. Now, Lord, move, we pray, in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, amen. Don't you wait. Don't you make anybody prod you. You are the only one who can keep you out of the presence of God. So don't let nothing do it. Amen. All right, let's go. Let's worship.
Oh, yes. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Bless his name.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. was for you. His sacrifice was for you. For your situation. Believe it. Know it. Know it in your bones. Know it in your heart. Whatever it is, lay it at the altar. Whatever it is, lay it at the altar. Leave it at the altar. Leave it at the altar. All sufficient sacrifice. It wasn't halfway done. It wasn't partially done. It wasn't an improper fraction, baby. It was done. 100%. Leave it at the altar. Because there is power in the name of Jesus. There's glory in the name of Jesus. There is peace in the name of Jesus. There is wholeness in the name of Jesus. Wholeness is in the name of Jesus. Wholeness in the name of Jesus. Wholeness is in the name of Jesus. Declare it over your household. Declare it over your family. His Son. There are those who are broken relationships with our parents, with our mothers, that we don't speak to anymore. There are people who are so forensic, their fathers don't speak to their children no more. Their children don't speak to their parents no more. And there are those of us who don't speak to our cousins no more. But the Lord is saying, I am here to heal. It is through you. You are my hope. You I have called to be a blessing. You I have made a blessing in your family. You are my hope. I have called you to be a light. I have called you to be salt. It is through you that I will make all things possible. Just lift up your hands. Just lift up your hands to me. And the Lord is saying, I am making you. I am making you alive to your family. I am making you my ambassadors. I am making you my healers. You will be my spokesperson. You will be my anointing. You will be my healer. Through you, your children will be a blessing. Through you, your parents, through you, your mothers, your fathers, your cousins will be a blessing. You will be a blessing. You will be a blessing. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And the Lord is speaking to somebody out in our Facebook or in our online. And the Lord is saying to you, go to your families. Go to your family that you have not spoken before to in a long time. There is forgiveness. There is healing. It doesn't matter if the other person or your family does not receive it. But you take your stand. You stand firm. You stand firm. And watch me do my work, says the Lord. Watch me do a wonder.
As Pastor Ken was giving that word, the Lord gave me on that same lines of restoring the family, but there's spiritual sons and spiritual daughters and spiritual fathers and spiritual mothers that God wants to begin to heal the broken relationships, bridging the gap in reference to legacies. It's time to begin to pour into them again. It's time to pour into them again. I don't know who that's to, but it's time for them to pour, you to pour into them again, and for them to pour into you. He wants to restore it. I don't know what, it doesn't matter what happened. It can be covered under the blood, but it's time to restore the relationship between fathers and sons, mothers and daughters. Not just in physical, not just in this, but spiritually as well. Hallelujah. 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 There'll be time for that at this altar. Hallelujah. How many of you today felt some chains break today? Hallelujah. It's only by His grace that is accomplished. Just sing this with me just one time. Just indulge me just for a moment. If that was you today, just simply lift your hands and say this with me today.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a blood, His mercy rests on every blood. Amazing grace, my chains are gone, my chains are gone.
alive as we think about the fact that he broke our chains by virtue of what he did at Calvary. Are your chains broken today? Because if they are, then he says that you are welcome at the table of the Lord. In this church, we believe in and practice an open communion, meaning that the only thing that's necessary is for you to be able to say, I've been washed in the blood. I've been saved. I've been set free. So as we sing it again, would you come get you a piece of the bread, and a cup of the juice, and then just gather together here at the front as we, and then once everyone's been served, we will partake. My chains are gone. Come on, y'all. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a flood, your mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone. My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love.
I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you. The same night in which the Lord Jesus was to be betrayed, he took bread, he blessed it, and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and said, take and eat all of this. This is my broken body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And would you remember his broken body today? In the same manner also, after he had eaten the bread, he took the cup, gave thanks to his Father, and gave it to his disciples, and said, this cup is the new and everlasting covenant, an agreement confirmed in my blood. As often as you drink this, you remember me. Would you remember his blood that was shed for the forgiveness of our sins as you partake? He said, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. And our prayer is, even so, Lord Jesus, come quickly. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. The God who called me, hear me, love me.
over needs. It's good to have Sister Gail home. I don't know where she is. She's hiding. Did she get raptured? Continue to pray for her. Her brother-in-law, Melvin, is continuing to have stuff going on. There are just a lot of things. Now, I got my mind lots of other places this morning, so it's hard for me to think of all of them. But if you have a need, then today I know the answer is Jesus. It's Jesus. And it always will be Jesus. Amen? And that hasn't changed. And so we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. Come on, Diane, come up here and pray over our needs today. And let's believe God for the folks. And if you have a need from heaven today, make sure you lift it up to the Father. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Gail, would you just put your hands on Grandma as we pray this morning? I know she has a physical need this morning. Would you stand, if you're able, would you stand as we go to the throne?
Thank you, Jesus.
Father, we thank you. We would be amiss not to. We thank you for your presence this morning. We thank you for how the Holy Spirit has moved in this place this morning. Up and down the aisles and in and out each row. On the platform and in our hearts. God, there are needs represented here this morning that we just don't know. But we bring them to the cross and we commit each and every need into your hands and into your care. Meet each need. Heal each body, all minds and nerves. Bring peace in the midst of storms. Give clear direction where that is needed. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. You are always welcome. Thank you this morning for meeting needs. We thank you this morning for what you've done, for what you're going to do. And we'll give you all praise and honor and glory in the precious name of Jesus.
Yes.
Amen.
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 Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Take a minute to just love on folks. Come on, take a second. Go around and hug. Go on.
Now.
Praise God. Praise Him. All right, let's have a seat. We'll let y'all fellowship and share just a little bit. We'll let y'all fellowship and share a little bit. Come on. There we go. Actually, no. No. Sorry. I'm afraid I have somebody else who's going to... Some very important people. Come on, y'all. Come help me with the offering. Come on. There you go. Now, don't take it yet, but when you go, you have to go to everybody. You go to everybody on that side. Give them a sad look if they don't put nothing in, okay? You go to everybody on that side. So, praise God. We'll greatly appreciate your prayer. You may have seen some commotion at the outset of the service. And we're trying to figure out why my car's been towed. But we will figure it out. It will all be good. I'm sure there's some sort of an error probably with the finance company. Either my error or their error. But we will straighten that out. But I am going to bring this message. And that the Lord's given. And I just see this as nothing more than an attempt to stop the word at the end of the day. So, but I'll appreciate your prayer to help us push through that. God's already done some wonderful things in this service. Today. What a powerful, powerful morning so far. And I believe in God to do even more of it. So, praise God. Well, already got it. But thank you. You can give Mama a ride.
Okay.
There we go. All right. So, but pray tomorrow that as we try to go through all the rigmarole. I've never been through that, but it's going to be an interesting day, I'm sure, trying to get whoever to do whatever it is that they have to do so that I can do what I got. Anyway. Well, yeah, I know that. I hadn't believed it was. Apparently, something didn't quite happen right. So, all right. That being said, let's prepare to give unto the Lord. I believe that as we give, this is why I can be confident. I've been faithful to the Lord in giving. And I know God watches over what I put into good ground. And He causes it to bear much fruit. And you can be too. And this is nothing, and maybe what you're going through is nothing more than an attempt for you to take your eye off of the seed that's been planted, to stop watering it, and to stop believing. But I guarantee you, if you'll be faithful in little things, He'll make you rule over much. Amen. That's His word. So that being said, who's taking the offering? Is it Thomas or is it Ken? Oh, come on, Ken.
I guess I was expected to do it right there from the keyboard, but praise the Lord, I don't have to do that. No problem. All right. Go ahead. Go ahead. All right, as they go around, I just wanted to share God is good, isn't He? God is good. God is so good. He has been so wonderful. I many of you have heard that I'm back in school. Very tough, but praise the Lord by His grace. And I think Melody is also praising the Lord, and she's in school as well. But just want to thank the Lord that He has been so wonderful to the two of us, and doing pretty good at school, given the challenges that we have going back to school after so many years. High school, yes. No. But we thank the Lord that it is by His grace. It is by His grace. And so, in your life, and I just want to encourage you, in your life, just like we're giving, you want to give to the Lord in your everyday life. Sven and I were talking earlier today, as we talk about the book of Acts, one of the things that really jumped at me was be able to give to the Lord at any time. It's a conscious decision. It's not God coming down from heaven in a booming voice and say, give. Does He do that?
No.
Where does it come from? The heart. Heart, well, heart, not mind, or however you do it. And so, we give cheerfully. Do you give cheerfully? Out of the mouth of babes. All right. Can you hold it up? hold it up high. Let's raise our hands. Let's just bless this gift and its tithe. Father, we just want to thank you, Father. We just bless your holy name. We just want to, Lord, to give back to you, Lord, what you have so freely given, your Son. Father, as we give, Lord, we just pray, Lord, your blessing, your anointing on these seeds, O God. Let it go forth, O God, from here, Father, Lord, to be seeds, O God, in elsewhere, O God. For the furtherance of your kingdom, O Lord, for your word, O God, to be established, Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we bless these tithe and offering, O Lord, as they go forth, Father. May you cause them to grow. Grow abundantly, Father. And may they be a blessing unto others. He's getting tired. But thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you to the two of you. Wonderful. All right. Anybody else has a testimony they want to share? We just want to love on the Lord and give him all the glory. He's just so wonderful. He deserves it. Anybody? Any takers? No? No takers? Okay. Praise the Lord. God is just good. We'll hand the time back to
me. Pastor Sam. All right. Yeah, that would help. It does. Very much so.
All right. Turn with me in your Bible this morning to the book of Acts, the 26th chapter. Acts
26? I don't need that. I have this. Pray, it's handwritten. Because I can sometimes not read my own writing. Huh? Well, they did it, but they probably had better handwriting back then, too. So, Acts chapter 26. Sure have missed y'all here. In all seriousness,
glad you're here this morning.
And so many of you, it's good. What a great looking bunch here today. My goodness.
So pretty.
I guess y'all don't think y'all are a great looking bunch. I don't know.
They
don't want to seem conceited. That's right. Okay. I'm going to leave that alone. Acts 25. So we arrive in Acts 26 after a very sordid OMG chapter 25. Let me refresh you on 25. In 25, Paul has a trial in front of Festus. Now his second trial, and again he is found to be not guilty, innocent of all charges. But Festus says, Festus is in a bad spot, because if he releases Paul, he's going to probably have a riot on his hands when the Jews try to take him and kill him. And he can't declare Paul to be innocent at the same point, because then he'll have a riot on his hands. And the Jews, and it doesn't go very well in ancient Rome when governors of a province have a riot in their province. The emperor has a solution for those governors. It's called regime change. Pop with your head. And this was, at this point, the emperor of Rome was one very famous Nero. Before he went totally haywire. But he was never a little saintly choir boy, okay? So Nero is on the throne. Festus has had this trial, has declared that there's really nothing wrong. But hey, do you want to go stand trial in front of the Jews down in Jerusalem? Paul says, no, you're not giving me what I deserve as a Roman citizen. I deserve to be set free. And no, I will not go to Jerusalem to stand trial, because if I do, they'll murder me. And so I appeal to Caesar. And as the right of every Roman citizen in ancient Rome was to take their case before the emperor. Well, Margaret, that poses another problem. Because now, Festus has to send this prisoner to Rome and has to tell the emperor what crime he's being charged with. And he's thinking, this is not going to be good. We have been holding for the better part of 2 years a Roman citizen in a Roman jail, and yet he has not been charged, not even found guilty. He's not even charged by the Roman government with a crime. What do I tell Nero? And so, lo and behold, that day, some very interesting people arrive from the neighboring province, or the Romans had a way of making people governors and kings over whatever province, but never forget, the real power was Nero. And so the king of the neighboring province, Agrippa, happened to just be in town. And Agrippa, well, brought his wife along with him. He also brought his sister, and it was just only one person that came with him. His wife was his sister. And before that, yeah. Now, if that's not sort of enough, before she married Agrippa, she'd been married to her uncle. So she liked to kind of keep it, you know, all in the face. I mean, she might have been from the back hills of Kentucky, for all you know. But here, she was married to her uncle. He died. And so what's the next best thing to being married to your uncle? Well, at least I know what I'm getting if I marry my brother. And so Bernice marries her brother. And, Grandma, that's not all. On the side, Bernice is also having an affair with a Roman general who would later succeed Nero as the emperor named Titus. Can we say sordid lives? Pretty sordid. And so Festus looks at these two clowns and says, well, since y'all have been down here for a long time working with these Jews and you know all this Jewish stuff, I have a really interesting prisoner. And maybe you can hear and you can tell me what to write to Nero on why he's standing in front of him. And so the Bible says at the close of Acts chapter 25 that the following day, King Agrippa, Queen sister, adulteress Bernice, along with Festus and his whole royal court, and all of the muckety-mucks, and all of the hoity-toities of that time and of that area, all got together at Festus's palace in Caesarea, and they brought out Paul, standing in front of them, in his chains. Can you imagine what you would have said to this bunch of clowns standing in front of you? Here you have pagan idolaters. You got people who worship Nero as God himself. You have a man who's married his sister, the sister who's committing adultery on her brother. Can we just, not to mention the fact that Agrippa probably was no little saintly choir boy either, because it was, as was common back in those days, he probably had a mistress or two and probably a little boy toy on the side as well. And here is Paul, a Pharisee of Pharisees, a Jewish zealot if there ever was one, getting ready to stand trial in front of these, there is no better word to put in front of it, but these heathens, right? I mean, downright heathenistic heathens, as heathen as they can get. Now, I have a mind of what I would have told this bunch. I would have started out with, I mean, that's what I would have started out. But strangely enough, that's not what Paul did. So now that we've laid the framework and the anointing's flowing, let's pray. Father, as we turn to your word now, open the bread of life to us. Help us to hear. Lord, help us to have ears that we might hear, eyes that we might see, and hearts that would receive what the Spirit of God is doing in this building today. And we will leave you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. So, Paul gets up in front of them and it starts out, "Then Agrippa said to Paul, you may speak in your defense." Now, let's make sure we remember, this is not a trial. Trial is long over with. He's already been found innocent twice. This is not a trial. There is no judicial finding that will come from this, no matter what happens in this. Paul has appealed to Caesar. He is in chains and he will remain in chains regardless of this. This is not really as much of a defense as it is a fact-finding mission. They're trying to figure out, what do we tell Nero? Is that a fair enough assessment of the situation? So when we read here, make your defense, basically what Agrippa is saying, all right, Paul, we're here. Tell us how it is. Tell us what's going on. You see, it was a fact-finding mission. And so we read here, you may speak in your defense. And so Paul, gesturing with his hand, started his defense. And listen to how he addressed it. "I am fortunate, King Agrippa, that you are the one hearing my case today against all of these accusations made by the Jewish leaders. For I know that you are an expert on all the Jewish customs and the controversies. Now please listen to me patiently." Now, we know the background, not a trial, fact-finding mission. Let me just tell you, there is so often that I get people calling me up on the phone, telling me about some controversy that's going on between them and another person. And you know how it usually is? It ain't right how they treat me. It's like I'm on trial in front of them all the time. They're just being persecuted for Jesus. Do you know anybody who has a persecution complex? Know anybody like that? Maybe you've been like that. Now, if it's you, or maybe it's the people online, I get it, it's the Facebook folk, let me just tell you, please get that off the cross. The wood is needed elsewhere. You are not on trial. Look at your neighbor and say, you are not on trial. You are not on trial. You know, so often people will ask you a question. So often people will look at your life and they will hold your life under a magnifying glass. And they will examine you and look at you closely. And it is not because they hate you. It's not because they hate all Christians. It's not because, as unlike our very conservative evangelical friends may think, that everybody wants to put the end to Christianity. No, they're on a fact-finding mission, most of them. They want to know a few very basic, elementary things. All Agrippa wanted to know was, who are you? Why are you here? What are you about? What have you done? And does your walk match your talk? That's what essentially the purpose of this time in front of Agrippa was, to figure out who are you and what are you about. And let me tell you, there are a lot of people who watch your lives and they may question your motives sometimes. They may question your intentions sometimes. And rather than you getting the persecution complex or the victim mentality, oh, these people are just dead set and opposed against me. No, honey, they just want to know, who are you? What are you about? What do you believe? And does your walk match your talk? Yeah. That's the end of it. And I will tell you that if your walk matches your talk, and if you can get up and you can say, I know who I am, then most people's questions will simply be settled. And a lot of some folks, it doesn't matter to them a hill of beans who you are and what you're about. What matters to them is what you said you are standing for. Is it a fair enough assessment to say that in our modern time, Christianity has a very bad reputation? Mm-hmm. I can think, and I've been in ministry now for 25 years. I cannot think of a time where the church has had a worse image and a worse reputation in our society than they do today. Our current political climate doesn't help things at all, does it? No matter what side you may be on, it does not help things. The church has scandal everywhere you look. You see preachers who are living way beyond their means and expecting the church to finance their lavish lifestyles. We have praise and worship times which have turned into more into rock concerts than they are actually times of ministry. You have preachers who no longer preach sermons, but who bring motivational, inspirational, makes you feel good, scratch you behind the ears messages. We have a form of godliness, but we deny the power of the gospel to actually transform and change lives.
Good.
And I will tell you that every single time, it is not just Jesus who in Revelation 3 gets an unpalatable taste in his mouth from the lukewarm church. It's the world. They go, I don't want none of that. Because if your life is not altered, if your life is not somehow changed, if there's no impact, if there is no transformation, then why waste the time going through all the motions every Sunday morning? Why put all the money in the plate? Why bother going through all of the stuff if it doesn't really do anything? If it's just another social club, I can find lots more entertaining places to go. Well, so no, it is not that the world is just out to crucify all of the Christians. Forgive the pun. No, it is not that there is this massive wave of persecution, a question and an eye towards, does your walk match your talk? It's not persecution. They're doing what they're supposed to be doing. You see, our lives are to be different, aren't they?
Yes.
Now, that doesn't, now notice I didn't say they are to be perfect. I had a conversation the other day with somebody who said, you know why I don't go to church, Brother Bill? Because it's where all the hypocrites are. That's where all them hypocrites go. Now my question to them was, well, where would you rather the hypocrites go? If they're hypocrites, isn't that a good place for them to be? Maybe they'll get their life touched in church. Maybe. Right? Best place for you to go if you're a hypocrite is to be in the house of God. You let this word get in you long enough, eventually it'll alter you if you let it. You see, many times we have altar calls without any altering, though. Oh, no, no, no. You see, we have great altar calls. We'll come down, get our Jesus fixed, Sister Gail, right? Like we need Jesus, like an addict needs their snuff of cocaine for the week. I can't make it unless I get my Holy Ghost goosebump. Well, honey, can I just tell you, your Holy Ghost goosebump, that... I don't know what purpose that actually serves. I'm happy you got a Holy Ghost goosebump, but what did it do for you? What has it done? What's it causing you to do? The altar call is supposed to alter you. It's supposed to change you. And what they were looking at here is, all right, let's take a look at this part. Because we're about to learn something new about Paul, that we've not learned yet all the way through these earlier chapters of Acts. We are about to find out a whole new piece of information. It's going to be gasp. CNN's going to have breaking news any second. Can we jump ahead just real fast? I'm not going to do this chapter in chronological order, but let me jump ahead. Look with me in verse number 9 through 11. He said, I used to believe that I ought to do everything I could to oppose the very name of Jesus the Nazarene. Indeed, I did just that in Jerusalem. Authorized by the leading priests, I caused many believers there to be sent to prison. And read that next line for me, everybody. Stop. I did what?
As my vote for against them.
cast my vote against them. Now, in less than 40 days, we're all going to go vote, right? Yeah. Did they get to vote back then?
No.
But he cast a vote. That word is very clear. He cast a vote. There was only one group of people that cast votes in ancient Israel. The Sanhedrin. You see, Paul is telling them who he used to be. Paul was not just a Pharisee of Pharisees. Paul was not a nobody. Paul had been a member of the ruling council of the Jews. He had been a learned scholar, not only a Pharisee who had memorized the Old Testament verse for verse from Genesis to Malachi. He had been a member of the ruling council. In other words, every one of these people standing in front of him, except for Festus, who was new to the scene, knew him. And they knew him well. This would be like Donald Trump standing in front of us today saying, look at my life, examine me. Or Hillary Clinton. It would be somebody that we would easily be able to say, I know that person. This is not somebody who's been living in the back corner somewhere under a rock. He'd been living a very public life. And when he experienced Jesus on the road to Damascus, I will tell you, it was an earthquake of biblical magnitude in the political realm of that land. Because now, one of the ruling council, one of the big muckety mucks, had converted and had had an experience with Jesus. They could tell if his walk matched his talk. They could tell his life was different. He had cast his vote. Not only had he gone so far as to cast his vote, which every other member of the council had done, he was so zealous, he said, not only will I cast my vote, I'll go round them up myself. I'll go get my hands dirty. I will go and I will arrest them, throw them in jail. Now there's another little side note to this. There is no way that was actually legal what the Sanhedrin was doing. You see, the Jewish Sanhedrin did not have the legal right to imprison or to execute anyone. None. And so now, a little bit of what Paul is doing is he's making the rest of the world aware of what's really been going on when they hadn't been watching. Maybe Rome, maybe the Roman government had noticed, that's possible, and had simply just kind of turned a blind eye to it in order to, you know, keep peace in the land. And Paul is telling Festus here, you let this get up to Nero, this is what's going to come out. These boys been over here. You're sitting here and you're accusing me of doing all these terrible things. Well, you've been breaking Roman law. Let me ask you right now, how does your walk match up to your talk? Now, I'm not talking necessarily, we could talk about here in the church house, that's fine. And sometimes we do have to talk about how our walk doesn't match our talk inside the church house and among church members. And let me tell you, sometimes, you know, I put on Facebook this week that what you post on Facebook can and will be used against you in this week's sermon.
I didn't read that.
Well, you didn't read that. We'll talk in a moment in front of everybody.
I didn't either.
But I will tell you more than that. I'm not so much concerned about what you do in the church house sometimes as much as what you do out there. Because I can deal with what happens up in here. But I can't fix your reputation in front of those people if your walk doesn't match your talk. Because make no mistake about it. Make no mistake about it. Your life is constantly under a microscope.
Come on.
How we speak, how we act, how we conduct ourselves, how we handle adversity, how we handle a car getting towed 10 minutes before church starts, or whatever else may be going on. How you live your life. Does your walk match your talk? Let me tell you, there's a whole lot of people who say they believe something the way that they don't actually really believe. Because I can prove what you believe by not by what you say. but by what you do. We say we believe that Jesus heals, and yet you get any group of Christians together, and within 5 minutes, sometimes it turns into an organ recital. You know what an organ recital is? It ain't nothing, playing that thing up there. Oh, my kidneys. Oh, my liver. Oh, my heart. Oh, these legs. Oh, my shoulders. Oh, this. Now, I don't live in denial. This past week, I strained my ankle. I ran a little bit too hard, and for 2 days, I kind of hobbled around. I was not in denial. It hurt. Right? But also one run on. Oh, everybody, look. Oh, my poor ankle. Because we ought to believe Jesus is the healer, or he isn't. Life and death is either in the power of the tongue, it isn't. We come up here, we pray for you to get healed, and then, you know, sooner have you hit the first row, you're digging in your purse for your aspirin and your Advil. Oh. We didn't even give time for that prayer to do nothing. Because you've already figured out your plan B. What if that prayer doesn't work? Well, that's good. I got my leave with me. I'll be all right. Now, honey, if you've been prescribed some medication, you take your medication. You do that. But, honey, if you're coming up here for prayer, then you better come up here to believe that what you're actually praying for is going to happen. You can say that. Again. But I won't, because I only got so much time in my message. Well, I'm not either, apparently. Well, yeah, I guess I could go for a while today. You see, then when you continue to look at it, some people are only your friends as long as you're doing what they want you to do. These guys on this Sanhedrin thought that Paul was the best thing to happen to cookies since chocolate chips and pretzels since salt, because he was doing what they wanted him to do. As long as he kept doing it, he was wonderful. And the moment he stopped, that heathen, that horrible, awful, no-down blasphemer, he's the worst thing ever, scoundrel, scumbag, he needs to... Deplorable! Oh, yes. Let me tell you, how many... And I've got to say this for myself, too. If the relationships that you are entering into are constantly one-sided, and it's only about what you can do for them, honey, that's not a relationship.
That's right.
Can I just say that one more time? That is not, some of you need to write this down. You need to write this down. That is not a relationship. That's called servanthood. Or what he said. That is not a relationship. That is you being a servant. It's you being a slave. In order to get what you want, you got to do what they always say. Honey, that's not the way a relationship works. In a relationship, I need to be about you and you need to be about me.
Yes.
And honey, that works that way whether you get married or whether you want to have friends. Otherwise, all that you're going to be is getting used. And all Paul was good for to this Sanhedrin was making sure that he did their dirty work. And as long as he did their dirty work, as long as he voted with them, as long as he didn't buck the trend, as long as he didn't do what he wanted instead of what they wanted, they liked him and thought he was wonderful. But then he met Jesus. Then he had an experience. Salt and pretzels. I
get it right.
You can have the instant replay directly after service on the Facebook. Okay. You see, my friend, as long as you keep doing what they want, they're good. The moment you stop and you start doing something else, well, now suddenly you're dirt. Well, now you know what you really were the whole time.
Yeah. Yes, that's good.
And I would just say that maybe for more people in the church house, we need to have some discernment to be able to figure stuff like that out early on rather than after the fact.
Yes, sir.
We are so addicted to the affirmation of people that we will hold on to people even when it only is because we're doing what they want. And we'll keep on doing what they want even when we don't necessarily think it's the right thing to do. Let me tell you right now, Paul knew the Old Testament law. He was as zealous if there ever was one. I'll bet you dollars to donuts he was a bit conflicted about some of the things he went and did on that road to Damascus, going to slaughter these people who had been guilty of nothing else except in believing in Jesus. Yeah, they didn't believe the way he did, but he also knew the Old Testament didn't give him any right to go and take away their livelihoods, to imprison them, or to do to them worse than what the Roman occupiers were doing. But he was willing to do it because, well, that's what his buddies liked. Let me tell you, now he's standing in front of these guys and the tables have turned. Right? Mm-hmm. There probably is. Yeah, that's probably a fair thing, but I still think there would probably some bit of conflict there within his heart. Just like I think that those men that fought in World War II on the opposing side, I'll bet you every single one of them, until their consciences were so seared, they knew what they were doing was wrong. They knew they were fighting for a losing cause. These SS men and these people who had fought, many who had fought very gallantly in World War I. Anyway, I don't want to belabor the point. My friend, not everybody who says they're your friend is your friend. Use some discernment, church. Use some discernment. And if you need some more information on that, come see our counselor right up here on the front row. He'll help you right quick. You see, but something changed. You see, there are people who have what I call an affirmation addiction. They need people to like them. They need people to validate their existence. Let me tell you, if you know Jesus, you don't need nobody else to validate your existence. If what he did on Calvary is not enough to validate your existence, nothing ever will be. Okay? But these guys were all about affirming Paul, and Paul was good until he was on the road. Now, again, I'm jumping all over this chapter, so you're following me, right?
Yeah.
All right. Look with me, verse 12 to 18. He says, "One day I was on such a mission to Damascus, armed with the authority and the commission of the leading priests. About noon, Your Majesty, as I was on the road, a light from heaven, brighter than the sun, shone down on me and my companions. We all fell down, and I heard a voice saying to me in Aramaic." By the way, I just got to pause there. I love this. In Aramaic he spoke. He spoke to him in the language he spoke. He didn't make Paul speak his language. He spoke Paul's. He spoke to him on a common level, the level of the common man. And he said, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It is useless for you to fight against my will." Of course, the King James says it is useless for you to kick against the goads. And I'll come back to that in just a moment. He says, "Who are you, Lord? Who are you, Lord?" And the Lord replied, "I am Jesus." And we're familiar with this story by now. "The one you are persecuting. Now get to your feet. I have appeared to you to appoint you as my servant and witness. Tell the people that you have seen me, and tell them what I will show you in the future. I will rescue both you and your people and the Gentiles. Yes, I'm sending you to the Gentiles to open their eyes so they may turn from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God. Then they will receive the forgiveness for their sins and be given a place among God's people who are apart by faith in me. So, King Agrippa, I obeyed that vision from heaven. I preached first to those in Damascus, then in Jerusalem, and throughout all of Judea, and to the Gentiles, that they must all listen, repent of their sin, and turn to God and what?
Prove.
prove they have changed by the good things they do. Some Jews arrested me in the temple for preaching this, and they tried to kill me. But God has protected me right up to this present time, so that I can testify to everyone. From the least to the greatest, I teach nothing except what the prophets and Moses said would happen, that the Messiah would suffer and be the first to rise from the dead, and in this way announce God's light to Jews and Gentiles alike. Now let me pause here for a second. He makes a very clear thing, all in line of the case he's been building. He's been telling them, you know me. You know who I used to be, and you know what I used to do. What I used to do said who I used to be. Because, my friend, behavior identifies your identity.
Yes.
Behavior identifies your identity. And your identity should drive your behavior. Is that right? But, I mean, when I go to Germany this month, the Germans are going to act like Germans. Why? Because they're Germans. I don't expect them to act like Malaysians. Because they're not. I expect them to act like Germans. Tubas and sauerkraut and bratwurst and all. Lederhosen and all that good stuff, right? And I will not be acting like them because I'm an American now. I've been Americanized. Let me tell you, the world is going to act like the world. I am never surprised that the world does worldly things. Is that fair? Yet we all act so shocked. Oh, those heathen, which brings me to my next point. Notice again when we jump back, and I'm not going to read the whole beginning of it. When Paul gets up and starts in front of a man who married his sister, the sister who married her brother and was having an adulterous affair on the side as well, and the guy who was involved in worshiping the emperor as a god, I read nowhere that he got up there and said, well, Agrippa, Bernice, Felix, I love you, but I hate your sin. As a matter of fact, I would dare anyone here today to show me here in probably what was one of Paul's largest audiences of unconverted people, to show me one time where Paul talked to them about their sin. Not one time. And yet we're going to have old boy standing out on the street corner out here in Houston, turn and burn! With a listing of everybody who's going to hell, including, from the last time I looked, Democrats. And Obama voters was the last time I saw. I was like, whoa, that's new, but okay. I hadn't read that one, but okay, sure. Well, you know, I remember people asking before, which are you, a Christian or a Democrat? And you might have it the other way, which are you, a Christian or a Republican? You know, that's fine. However you want. He never one time got up there pointing out how all of them were sinners. You know why? He expected them to act like sinners. Because he was speaking to a room full of sinners. Now, when he got in front of the church, when he got in Corinth, and he wrote to Corinth, he said, such immorality is being practiced among you, such as is not even known among the Gentiles. Judgment begins in the house of God.
Yes.
It is right.
Good.
It is right in the church house to call out sin. It is right. And it needs to be called out because sin is a reproach to any people. And it totally detracts your witness. But in front of these guys, he didn't talk to them about their sin. Boy, we could learn a good lesson here, couldn't we?
Oh, yes.
What did he spend his time talking about? Jesus. 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 Jesus crucified, Jesus buried, and Jesus risen from the dead. That's what he talked about. And let me tell you, if we are to make any change in this world, if we are to be a transformative church, what we need to be preaching on is Jesus-centric, not sin-centric. What you focus on is what will grow. And my friend, I have no intention to have sin grow any more than it already does. I'm going to preach on Jesus. I'm going to make Him great. He said, if I lift Him up, He'll draw all men unto Himself. People don't need to hear. There is no way. I will tell you, Agrippa and Bernice had lived long enough in Judea to know that the Torah and the law strictly forbade what they were doing. In no uncertain terms. They knew it. They didn't need Paul to whip out his Bible and say, see right here in Leviticus chapter 18, verse so and so it says, honey, this is not an encyclopedia for you to pull out and use as a weapon against someone. The living word is Jesus Himself. Make the living word known and the written word will become manifest among you.
What about that? Yeah.
That's all that Paul did. Paul pointed out to Jesus and he said, as an example of that, I present to you exhibit number one, me.
Come on now.
I was a member of the Sanhedrin. I cast my vote against them. Not only did I do that, I went and I rounded them up. I had them killed. They laid their coats at my feet. I don't believe that this is the totality of what Paul said. I think Luke shortened it. I will bet you that Paul went into explicit detail on the things he had done. He said, if you want proof that the gospel changes lives, you don't need to go look anywhere else. Look at me. Look at me. Look at my life. Oh, let me wrap this up here. He tell you there is salvation apart from no other name but the name of Jesus. So a lot of people running around today saying that you don't have to make a decision. Oh, once you know, you don't even need to know about it. Jesus saved everybody. Let me tell you, Jesus forgave everybody, but not everybody's been reconciled. I don't have to beg for His forgiveness. His forgiveness was freely given. All I have to do is repent in order to be reconciled. What is repentance? Having the same mind in me that was in Jesus. Homologeos. And what did Jesus do? Everywhere that He went, He did good. Healing the sick. Helping the oppressed. My friend, your good works bear a testimony of the fact that you have been saved. Not because you have been saved. Grace and obedience work hand in hand. You cannot have one without the other. You see, grace is what drives me. It was His good grace that compels me. And then on top of that, I've made Him my Lord. And Jesus looks at Paul and says, I don't know why you're kicking against the ox goads. It's useless for you. An ox goes like a cattle prod. The more you resist, dumb old stubborn ox, the more I want to prod. Haven't you ever noticed that when you don't want to do what the Lord tells you to do, the Lord in His unrelenting love comes after you and says, all right, we can do it your way, baby, or we can do it my way, but you are going. It is you. Some of us need to stop kicking against the ox goads. Life will be a whole lot better for you the moment you stop and just go ahead and acquiesce to His will. I have a way of finding that He kind of wins. Just about all the time. And so after He addresses Agrippa and He tells what He's been doing, suddenly, verse 24, Festus shouted, Paul, you are insane. You are out of your mind. You are, he kind of says, too much study has made you crazy. You've been so open-minded, your brain done fell out. Let me tell you, not everything is that explainable, is it? I love what happened up in here today. Because to some folks, we would have to explain that. And let me tell you, if nothing happens that you don't got to explain to some folks,
the miraculous thing happening in your midst. Jesus is not commonplace. Jesus doesn't do things ordinarily. Jesus sometimes does things a little bit that make people go, what in the world is the craziest thing I have ever seen? This whole thing about speaking in tongues, isn't that just a little crazy? That's pretty, it's, Ken, that's out there.
It's out there.
I mean, do you remember the first time that somebody told you about that? Well, maybe you were young and maybe it wasn't that hard for you to believe. I was a little bit older. I'd been raised and I got saved, Grandma, in an independent Baptist church, and we didn't do that there. If somebody had spoken in tongues, they'd have been this huge, they'd have sucked all the ceiling tiles in. I mean, we might have had people passed out dead. And I remember I was maybe 14, 15, 16 years old, and started hearing about this whole thing about the baptism and the Holy Ghost, Patrick, and getting filled with the Holy Spirit, and the initial physical evidence of speaking in tongues. And you know what I thought? That is absolutely, totally the most insane thing I have ever heard. You're telling me you all pray for me, and then I'm going to babble. That's the comment. I mean, that's as plain as I can make it. But if you read the book, that's what it says. Let me tell you, sometimes what the Lord has you do, it might make you look a little insane. Yeah. But realize this, look at what Paul does. Festus shouted, Paul, you are insane. Too much study has made you crazy. But Paul replied, I am not insane, most excellent Festus. And here is why. Let me tell you all about me. What? No, he didn't do that. Notice what he says. What I am saying is the sober truth, and King Agrippa knows about these things. He didn't sit there and try to convince everybody of his way. He didn't get out the Old Testament and start going word for word and line for line. And well, in the Hebrew it says this. So often we spend so much time trying to convince people who have no interest in being convinced. Instead, why don't you use some discernment and let the Holy Spirit show you who is ready to hear the gospel, and you make sure you let your witness shine in front of them. Yes, I'm going to let my life shine in front of everybody, people who are interested in Christ and people who are not. But I'm also going to be very mindful of who to engage in a conversation and who not to even bother engaging in a conversation. Again, this is something I would love to tell them boys from the Bulldog Ministries. I'd love to go picket at all sorts of things, including the Texas Children's Festival, standing out there protesting about all these people going to hell. I said, well, have you ever bothered to actually get to know somebody and discern whether or not they're ready to hear the gospel and whether or not they're ready to make a decision? And Paul picked up on something, that while Festus was looking at him like he had three heads, because remember, Festus is a typical Roman. He has just arrived down here in this weird, crazy backwater province all the way from Rome. But Agrippa's been here. And Agrippa knows the Old Testament. Agrippa comes from a Jewish family. And there was some potential there. And I can just imagine that Agrippa's been leaning in on his seat, listening very, very intently. Paul looks at Agrippa, and he says, Agrippa knows these things. I speak boldly, for I am sure that these events are all familiar to him. He had been there when Jesus had heard of all these controversies. He had seen the persecution of the church by the Jews. And then he says, I speak boldly, for I'm sure that these events are all familiar to him, for they were not done in a corner. King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets? I know you do. Now, Paul was a smart man, Cheyenne. Paul is using some really smart debate tactics here, right? Essentially, he is laying out the case. Because now King Agrippa is being placed in a box. If Agrippa says, yes, I believe the prophets,
Then he is leading a group who already knows that the logical next stop is that Jesus is the fulfillment of these prophets. And he's going to be in a lose-lose with the Jews. He also knows that if Agrippa now says, "No, I don't," he's going to have a riot on his hands from all the religious hoity-toities who claim to believe the prophets but don't really necessarily believe the prophets. And so, Agrippa, not a dumb man, jumps up and almost in jest looks at him with a little bit of a laugh and says, Oh, Paul, you think you can persuade me that easily to become a Christian? And let me tell you, I think Paul was doing a pretty good job of it right there. And I can only imagine Paul with the same little smirk looking on his face, looking at him, waiting for the snickering in the room to stop from all of the others, and Paul to say, whether it takes me a short time or a long time. Let me just pause there for a second before I get to the last part of what he says. Honey, too many people are in it for the short haul.
Yeah. Yeah.
They're trying to get to home and run on the first date. They just think that you're just going to go walk up to somebody out on the street. Hello there. Have you heard of the four spiritual laws? And immediately, they're going to fall on the ground, repent of their sin. The Holy Ghost's going to fall on them right there. Honey, that's not the way it usually works. It could, but it ain't how it usually goes. You know how evangelism works? Relational. I get to know you. I value you. I affirm who you are without necessarily affirming everything you're doing. I don't need to even talk about what you're doing if I just affirm and value you. He addressed him as esteemed King Agrippa, not you adulterous, whore-mongering, incestuous heathen, thinking that might not have been the most convincing way. But you know what? He respected him for who he was, not for what he did. Can I just say, if we'll start respecting people for who they are, treating them like people who have souls, who God loves immensely with an immeasurable love, I promise you that as they get to know you and as they see your life, they will come to know Jesus. Yes. And Paul says, whether it takes me a short time or whether it takes me a long time, that's irrelevant to me. I'm willing to pay the cost, and I'm in this for the long haul. So many of us, God speaks to us about something, and boy, we'll be quick to start, but we won't be long to go. When things don't bear the fruit immediately that we think that it should, if we don't have all of it, if we don't get all of the acclaim and all of the accredit and all of the affirmation that we're looking for, oh, I'm just going to fold up my tent and go where they like me. Paul said, whether a short time or a long time, I hope to convince not only you, but every one of you in this room. Every one of you. And you know there were some of those folks there too. Every one of you in this room to become just like me. And then with a little bit of a smirk, well, except for these, holding up his chains. I guarantee you there was silence in that room just as there is now. Because there was no counter-argument to what he had just said. What could they say? They knew who he had been, and they knew who he was now. Can people change? Mm-hmm. Yes, they can. But not without the transforming power of Jesus. Not without the transforming blood of Jesus. But I will tell you, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow.
No other fount I know but the blood of Jesus. If you've been to the fountain, then my friend, you're clean and you're different. And if you hadn't been that different yet, well, come on, let's get you another dip. Let's get you transformed and actually not just saved here, saved, so that good works are following your life. Those works are not saving you. They're testifying of your salvation. I hope that every one of you, Paul says, will become like me. You are exactly who I used to be. Here is who I am today. I would that you all be like me. And let me tell you, I know you, but I don't know you. Right? You show me what you want me to see. I show you what I want you to see. You don't know what goes on at home. I don't know what goes on in your day-to-day life. But I ask you, could you get up in front of that crowd and say, I would that you all be like me, but for these. Could you say that? If not, no condemnation. Just simply a matter of saying, let's continue to focus our heart and our attention on becoming more like Him. Stop kicking against the goads. It's useless. All you're doing is hurting your own testimony. That's it. All you're doing is giving Him a bad name. I remember in that independent Baptist church when we had an invitation at an altar call. Just as I am, number 145 in the hymnal. We sang all 18 verses every Sunday, and if anyone even moved on verse 17, we had to sing at least 3 or 4 more. Everybody knew, don't go to the bathroom on the... But one of the things we used to come down, and we would, and down, and you know, obviously in our churches, we'll call it backslide. But I like how they put it. If you've hurt the testimony of Jesus, come on. Let me tell you, your life is His life. And if your life does not match up with what this book says, there's one simple thing to do. Keep coming back. Stay in a place of repentance. Keep coming to the altar and letting His word alter you. Oh my goodness. With that, Bernice and Agrippa, sensing the awkward moment, not wanting for him to get called the organist to come to the organ to start having the altar call, figured that that was as good of a time as any. And so Agrippa said, well, thanks a lot, Paul. Been great hearing you. We're going to go. And with that, they all got up and they left, and Paul went back to his cell. Luke describes the conversation. We don't know how he knows the details of the conversation. Maybe he walked right behind them and overheard it. Agrippa looks at Festus and says, there's no fault in this man. Had he not appealed to Caesar, he could be a free man today. But Paul knew what the Holy Spirit had told him. Brother Ken, come on. My chains are gone. Something frilly. Thank you for giving that direction. Brother Carlos and I were talking at the end of last week's service. After Paul makes this dramatic appeal to Caesar, Laura, and he says, well, I appeal to Caesar. Paul, he said, well, why? Why would he do that? I mean, it seems like a death wish. There's more than that, though. As I went back and I read the preceding chapters, back in chapter, I think it was 19, the Holy Spirit spoke to Paul while he was sitting in a prison cell in Jerusalem. And he said, you have testified of me here in Jerusalem, and you've been faithful. And now you need to go to Rome. And now as Paul is standing there and he has heard the Holy Spirit, Melinda, give very clear and explicit direction. You need to go to Rome. I'm sure Paul is saying, like, that's not in the budget. I've been sitting in a prison cell for 2 years really having a whole lot of income. Ain't no overtime sitting in prison, Margaret. How am I going to get to Rome? Standing there in Festus's court with every unfair accusation being hurled against him, accusations to which he was totally innocent, I believe the Holy Spirit whispered in his ear, remember that thing about Rome? It's useless for you to kick against the goads, Paul. I'll provide you in a way. All expenses paid. You know what to do. I don't think Paul knew that it would cost his life. I think Paul probably in the back of his mind thought, well, I've been found innocent 3 times. Huh? What's one more? But it was a price he was willing to pay. Because there is always the possibility. Roman emperors were not known as kind, benevolent people. Roman emperors who thought of themselves as God on earth didn't probably take too kindly to hear about some other God who is supposedly a God above all gods, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Paul knew the risk he was taking, but it was useless for him to kick against the goads. Whether it in the short term or whether it costs me everything, I am willing to do whatever it takes that you all become like me, Paul says to his audience. I just don't want to see you end up in these. And it was his outcome that in the end, it took 300 years later, but eventually, because he went to Rome, and members of his own, of Caesar's own household, ended up coming to faith in Jesus. The gospel was spread, and here we sit today. Can I ask you to stand with us today?
Thank you, Lord, for your anointing. Come on, lift your hand today in this house. My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy will unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone. My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, your mercy rains unending love. Amazing grace.
Would you join me at this altar?
Amazing grace, how sweet.
That saved me.
Like me.
you, can you be a Paul? Can you stand here and say that whatever chains you may have or just chains in this old world, that your chains are gone? They're gone, and I would that all men be like me, that they know Him, that they know the power of the gospel, that they have their life transformed. Can you say that today? If you can, then you are a people who have a hope. You are a people who have a hope that Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection means eternal life. And your life now will mean life for them as they see and as they watch. Stop giving a defense for everything. Your life is not on trial. You don't need to think that you're being persecuted. Just let them see who you are, what you're about, and more importantly, who He is and what He has done in you. And I promise you, you will change your world if you do that. Amen. Can I, everyone, lift your hand and say, my chains. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My chains are gone, I've been set. Come on, declare it, declare it. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My chains are gone, my chains are gone, I've been set. My God, my Savior, my God, my Savior, has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns unending. Amazing. And Father, in the name of Jesus today, we offer our lives before You as a sacrifice, and we ask You, Lord Jesus, use it. And Father, it might not only be pleasing before You, but Lord, it might bear testimony and witness. That is who I used to be, but then I met Jesus, and my life has changed. And now I would that all men be like I am, free, 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 and He who the Son sets free is free indeed. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. Oh my goodness. This week, live like free people. And live like other people's lives are depending on it. Because it is. Amen. Amen. Pastor Ken, come on, pray over this people today as we cry out.
Thank you, Lord. We thank You for that name that is unchanging, but that is changing us every day to be just like You, Lord Jesus. Father, Lord, remind us this week, oh Father, so You are now, Lord, that we have been transformed again, made new, Lord, in Your image, in the image of Your Son, Jesus, to be a light unto this world, to be a salt unto the earth, Lord. Lord, as we go on and do all the world,
so I speak over you this week. The Lord will bless you and keep you. The Lord will smile on you and be gracious to you. He will show you His favor and give you His peace. Our worship is not over. Our service is just beginning. Let's go be the people of God. Amen. If you never had a reason to, you do now. I love you all. God bless you. We'll see you Tuesday night at 7:30 or Sunday at 11:00.